Welcome to Lecture 3 of Module 10. We've done it. This is the final lecture of the class. I hope you're going to enjoy it. We're going to be talking about the Mach-Zehnder Interferometer. This will be looking back at the material that we did in Modules 3 and 4, but now with a more mathematical sense and a mathematical description of the experiments. And we're also going to be understanding exactly what is meant with single photon interference, which is the last step and the last bit of information you need to really fully understand a photon. So let's start by reviewing the beam splitter itself. You can see the image of the beam splitter on the upper right. In the previous class, we examined this in both heterodyne and homodyne detection. And one of the things that we did was we were expressing the electric fields that come in the output ports 3 and 4 in terms of the electric fields that are incident on the beam splitter in ports 1 and 2, and we thought of having different initial states incident into ports 1 and 2. They are related in terms of these reflection and transmission amplitudes, R and T, and those are complex numbers that satisfy modulus squared of R plus modulus squared of T is equal to 1, because the photon either reflects or is transmitted. We're ignoring absorption in all of the work that we're doing on this. Now, the minus sign in E4 that's multiplying the R is coming from the fact that the reflected light from port 2 goes through glass before it reflects, and that's the same thing as the six-hour rule where we were adding 6 hours to the clock hand when we were looking at the arrows rotating and reflecting off of glass. In particular, for a Mach-Zehnder interferometer or for a balanced homodyne detection, we will be working with R and T both equal to 1 over the square root of 2, and then we can rewrite our expressions in this much simpler form that is written for you on the bottom of the page. E3 is 1 over square root of 2E1 plus 1 over square root of 2E2, and E4 is 1 over square root of 2E1 minus 1 over square root of 2E2. And of course, I did not put the hats in these, but of course, these electric fields are represented in terms of operators, in terms of the raising and lowering operators, A and A dagger. So let's now go into looking at the Mach-Zehnder interferometer. If you look carefully at the Mach-Zehnder interferometer, especially in the upper left corner and in the lower left corner, you can see each of those look like beam splitters that we've been working with. Of course, the beam splitter on the bottom has the silvered surface flipped so that we enter the glass coming from port 3 as opposed to coming from port 4, but nevertheless, it's the same beam splitter. It's the same kind of analysis. So the analysis of a Mach-Zehnder interferometer essentially requires us to analyze a beam splitter twice and to also add in the phase difference that occurs when I go on either of the two paths, the reference path or the sample path. In this case, the sample path is the lower path. In previous examples, we were taking the sample path as being the upper path. So the determinations of the fields, as I mentioned before, have already been done by doing the beam splitter. And we're going to be defining the path difference delta, which is just a number, to be k, k being the wave vector of the monochromatic light that I'm shining onto the Mach-Zehnder interferometer, multiplied by the difference L3 minus L4. And then just before we enter the second beam splitter, then the electric fields in the 3 port, which is the horizontal port entering the beam splitter, has a representation given by e to the I KL3 over square root of 2 times E1 plus E2. And E4, which is the port coming in from the vertical direction, is e to the I KL4 over square root of 2 times E1 minus E2, the minus sign coming from that adding of 6 hours on the second port as it goes through into the fourth port. So now we just have to take those E3s and E4s and multiply them by the R's and the T's and add them together, taking into account that there's a minus sign upon reflection from port 3 when it goes into port 5. So after going through, what we find is the following results. E5 is given by e to the I KL3 over 2, that's including a multiplication by 1 over square root of 2, minus E1 minus E2 plus e to the I KL4 over 2 E1 minus E2. That overall minus sign on the first term is coming from that minus R that I was describing just before showing you the formula. And then the E6 is e to the KL3 over 2, E1 plus E2 plus e to the I KL4 over 2 E1 minus E2. All right, now we're going to recombine these together. We're going to factor out an e to the I KL3 plus L4 over 2. That leaves behind factors of delta that are either plus or minus delta over 2. So we're going to get, there's still a 1/2 in front, and the field E1 is multiplied by minus e to the I delta over 2 plus e to the minus I delta over 2. E2 is multiplied by minus e to the I delta over 2 minus e to the minus I delta over 2. E6, E1 is multiplied by e to the I delta over 2 plus e to the, that should be minus I delta over 2, small typo there, plus e to the I delta over 2 minus e to the minus I delta over 2 multiplying E2. Now we just use the definitions of cosine and of sine, and we can rewrite those in terms of cosines and sines. What we find is E5 has that phase factor in front, and then it's minus I sine delta over 2 times E1 minus cosine delta over 2 times E2, and the E6 is cosine delta over 2 E1 plus I sine delta over 2 E2. Okay, so it's complicated, but it's really not that hard. We're just applying our rules for the beam splitter twice, and we just have to collect terms, that's all. So this gives us what the electric fields are, but we really want to be working with those raising and lowering operators. And because the electric fields are proportional to them, we can just immediately put in that substitution into the latter operators. And it just requires essentially replacing the E's by the A's. All right, now from this, we can now calculate expectation values. So we can now measure the number operator. We're going to be measuring it with an input state, psi in, which has a vacuum on port 1, and it has a large amplitude field on port 2. Just calculating a dagger 5, a 5, and taking the expectation value, noting that the input state on port 2 is a classical state, we get modulus alpha squared cosine squared delta over 2, and calculating a dagger 6, a 6, and calculating that expectation value, we get modulus alpha squared sine squared delta over 2. You can fairly easily see that that's what's going to come out just by looking at the different expectation values and the fact that the A operator annihilates the vacuum on the right and the A dagger operator annihilates the vacuum on the left. So the only terms that can contribute are the A2 dagger A2 terms in both of those expressions. And one is multiplied by a cosine, the other by a sine. So it's pretty simple. We now take the difference of those two. We find the expectation value of N6 minus N5 is just given by the difference of those, sine squared minus cosine squared. If you look at your half angle or double angle formulas, you see that we can replace that by minus alpha squared cosine delta. And it turns out we're going to be working with delta close to pi over 2. And the reason why is it's actually quite easy to measure when a signal is supposed to equal 0. We measure the amount that is non-zero simply by counting photons. Okay, so if I re-express that difference, those operators, N6 minus N5, in terms of the fundamental operators, I find that that difference is proportional to the cross term. So it's A1 dagger A2 minus A2 dagger A1. I can evaluate that A operator, and assuming that the phase on that state that is coming in on port 2 is equal to 0, we just replace that by the modulus of alpha. And you see then we have an I times an A1 dagger minus an A1. We go back and look at our definition of the quadrature operators, and we see that that's actually proportional to the P quadrature operator. We can then go ahead through a much longer calculation to calculate the expectation value of N6 minus N5 quantity squared. It's actually a rather long calculation, even though the final result ends up being relatively simple. Modulus of alpha squared 2 over h bar expectation value of the square of the quadrature in state, the state that is incident on port 1. And what that tells you is that the fluctuations are proportional to the vacuum fluctuations in port 1. And that also means that if I could find a way of reducing that, then I'm going to be able to get a more accurate experiment. So it turns out the fluctuations in this experiment are actually due to the vacuum fluctuations in port one. Even though I'm not putting any light into it, it has fluctuations. And we can set that to a lower value by using a squeezed vacuum. Now, a squeezed vacuum actually has some light that's input into that. And we're going to discuss this in detail in the class where we talk about how LIGO works, because this is one of the features that is put into LIGO to make the experiment work better. All right, the last thing I want to talk about is single photon interference. It is the final property you really need to know to understand what a photon truly is. So I'm going to illustrate for you how we can actually measure single photon interference. It's the last topic that we have in the lectures of this course, and I think it's a rather fitting end having a clear discussion on wave-particle duality. Now, notice that our photon detector, which is the photomultiplier tube, is really emphasizing the particle aspect of the photon. It simply counts photons, and it acts as if each photon comes in as a single lump, and we detect the lump as it is incident on the detector. How do we see this full wave-particle duality using detectors that are emphasizing the particle aspect of the photons? Can we do it? The answer is actually yes, we can. And let me show you how. So we're going to be looking again at our Mach-Zehnder interferometer. We're going to have a single photon source incident on port 2. And we're going to just count the photons that come in detectors 5 and in detector 6, and we're going to just measure them. So what I'm going to show you here is what that looks like. So I want you first to focus on the top part of that graph. That's showing what happens when I have a small number of photons, about 0.1 photons per second in each channel, and I believe it is counting over a period of about 1 second. And then if I count over a period of 10 seconds, I get about 1 second per channel, and then I have 10 seconds. And what you can see is initially it looks like it's random, maybe with a little bit of structure to it, but eventually you see that it actually pulls out this nice oscillating behavior. Now, compare and contrast those images on the bottom panel with the schematic images on the left and the right near those channels that are counting the number operators. You can see that this is actually working incredibly well. And in fact, the visibility in this, which tells you how big those fringes are, is about 0.98. So it's a really good single photon interference experiment. This is one of the first ones that was working with that calcium cascade single photon light source. The more modern experiments use CCD cameras rather than photomultiplier tubes. And the way to get a CCD camera at work is to use a Fresnel double prism. I'm not going to explain to you what a Fresnel double prism is. Just remember it gives you some interference fringes. And those interference fringes are going to be shown right on that CCD camera. So I can then look at those interference fringes as a function of time by reading off that CCD camera as a function of time. And again, with a short time, I just see kind of a random pattern. If I wait a longer time, I can start to see some structure appearing. If I wait an even longer time, I have a very clear interference pattern. And if I then take a line that cuts right through the center of that C plot in the horizontal direction, what you see is those fringes have amplitudes that are given exactly by what a simulation says they should be for a single photon source. So it really is showing you that this model and description that we've been giving for single photon sources is truly describing what this behavior is. All right, we've reached the end of the class, aside from our one classwork that we're going to do where we're going to explain in detail how LIGO works. Let me just summarize the final lecture and the properties of a photon, which is what we've been studying this week, and then I'll have just some very short concluding words about the class itself. So these two experiments are illustrating the general principles of a photon, and I want to just go over those for you once again so that you can remember them. Photons have a definite particle number, but they do not have a definite energy or a definite frequency. They have a finite extent in time. This is given by the extent or the width of the wave packet that is describing the photon. They can be detected only once, and then they're gone and destroyed. They are detected as discrete lumps, and they always have the same size. Every photon has the same size in a photomultiplier tube. They show interference patterns after many of them are collected. So that shows that single photon interference actually occurs. Precisely how it occurs, we still don't really have a great explanation about exactly how that happens. But our theory, it automatically comes out of our theory because we're working with probability amplitudes. Now, next up, we're going to describe how LIGO works in class. That's going to be the last thing that we have done. And I just want to have a couple of ending thoughts for you. I hope that you've enjoyed the way that we have gone through quantum mechanics in this class. I have taken the time to emphasize an operator-based approach to quantum mechanics. It's a rather unique approach. You won't find many other people do it this way. You won't find a lot of resources about it on the internet. But I do find that it's a much more physical way of dealing with quantum mechanics, and it helps you avoid feeling like all you're doing is learning math. I've also taken a lot of time to emphasize the physics part of the class, showing you lots of different experiments and experimental outcomes and explaining how we can understand those experimental outcomes, applying the theory that we have developed. The course is complicated. The course is difficult. The course takes a lot of effort to get through the material. But I want you to know that having gone through this material, you now are really quite sophisticated quantum mechanics in your knowledge of quantum mechanics itself, and you will be able to do lots of interesting things with it. I want to encourage you again to always follow the rules that we have. Know what you know, apply what you know to the problem at hand to get you toward the answer, and remember that there's only a handful of important identities and important properties you ever need to know on any problem in any circumstance in order to get to the answer that you're trying to seek. And this is a mindset that will really help you a lot when you get into research and you move into doing problems that no one has solved before. So I enjoyed spending the time this semester with you. It was actually fun interacting in the online environment. It would have been nicer had we been able to be together, but we were only able to do it in an online environment, and that's okay. I think that you were able to learn a lot in this class, and I hope that you enjoyed it as well.